Good evening. So I'll just keep it short. So where do we stand currently in orthopedic research in the international arena? So I had divided this presentation into three areas, like where do we stand, the reasons as to why we are standing here, and what is the way forward. So what are the measures to assess where we are standing? So it's easy to pose the question, but if you assess quantitatively where we are standing, so there are three measures by which we can assess. One is the number of publications so far we have produced in orthopedics, the quality of these publications, and the number of orthopedic journals exclusively produced in India. So scientific publications are one of the important indicators of scientific growth, and number of scientific publications towards the global output contributed by each country is one of the critical indicators by which we assess the strength of research in a nation. So most of my values I have got is from this site called Schimago, which gives a journal and country rating based on the number of publications produced by each of the countries over the last few years. So it has data about 176 countries, and if you can see the position of India, this is research including every specialty like medical, chemical, mechanical, everything included. As expected, the United States stands top, and India stands at a position of number 9. So it also gives the position of India in orthopedic research. So if you can see the orthopedics and sports medicine, and the data is for the last 20 years, we are standing at a position of 19. So compared to the overall position of 9, we have come down to 19. So as you can see, there are different columns into which it has been classified. So this is based on the number of publications so far produced by our country in the last 20 years. But there is a different indicator as well, which I will come into in a short while. So compared to the top country, United States, which stands at number 1, which has produced 1,04,260 publications in the last 20 years, India has produced 3,368, but still we stand at number 19, which is not bad. So coming to the quality of these publications, so H index, it is an index which is used to measure the quality of these publications, meaning by it assesses the number of papers produced by each country and how many times these papers are getting cited in other publications. So if the publication is a good one, then it has to be cited in other publications, so it has much more better value. So based on the H index, now our ranking has come down still further. So in orthopedics, in the last 20 years, based on H index, we have come to number 31. And when we compare it to the topper, so which has a H index of 304, we have a H index of about 50. So the quality of publication again can also be assessed by two other parameters. One is the number of publications we produce in the top 1% of the orthopedic journals, and the number of non-cited articles, which means once an article is written and published in a paper, it has to be quoted at least once in any of the other publications. But if it doesn't get quoted in any of the other publications, it's called as a non-cited publication. So coming to the first parameter, the share of Indian publications in top 1% of journal is only 0.5%. Rest of the 99.5% is in the rest of the other journals. And the second parameter, the non-cited article, and the percentage of non-cited papers from India is 47.3%, which means one in two papers which we are able to write and publish finally doesn't get cited by anybody else. So coming to the other parameters, the number of journals in India and the standard of these orthopedic journals. So there are four PubMed indexed journals in from India, the Indian Journal of Orthopedics, Journal of Clinical Orthopedics and Trauma, Journal of Orthopedics, and Journal of Orthopedic Case Reports. So, but Schimago has information about these two journals, only these two journals, only the Journal of Orthopedics and the Indian Journal of Orthopedics. So that was for the recent year, that is for the last year 2015. And coming to the publication for, number of journals in the United States, so we have almost 65 journals exclusively dedicated to orthopedics. The topmost journal is American Journal of Sports Medicine with an impact factor of 3.33. Skimorgan has a different journal ranking called as the SJR. So I had a brief comparison between India and USA. So number of journals is 65. From India, it's 2. If you take the highest impact factor journal, and that is the American Journal of Sports Medicine, it is 3.3. Whereas Indian Journal of Orthopedics has 0.39. But that is the 0.39 is the impact factor given by Skimago. Whereas based on the Thomson Reuters, what we call as an impact factor, our IGO has a 0.64. So based on H-index and number of citable publications, number of sites for each of these journals, so we are still far behind. So are we doing bad? No, as you see in the, we see the development of our journals in the last few years, I think we are improving tremendously. So if we take the Skimago ranking for Indian Journal of Orthopedics compared to 2008, our impact factor has improved by 3 times. So from 0.12, we have improved to almost 0.4 now. And number of citable publications has also increased by 4 times. From 75 publications in the year 2008, we have come up to 336 in the last year. So that's a good change. Similarly, the total number of research papers also has improved considerably. From in the last decade of 2000, from 75,000, we have improved to almost 1 lakh in, from 2001 to 2005. And the number of citations has also increased. So this is a graph which shows the total number of publications, which has tremendously increased compared to 1998. The percentage of publications has improved 200% in 2007. So this, we did a small study specifically restricted to spine surgery publications in the last 14 years. So even though initial publications in the year 2000 and 2001 was very less, so as you can see, it was only 10 articles at the time. So in the last year between 2009 and 2014, we had seen a 440% increase in the publications, so which is a very good sign. So we can see light at the end of the tunnel, and what are the hurdles and what we can, what is the way forward, what else we can do? So one is that we don't have a formal training in research methodology in our undergraduation and post-graduation. So even though we conduct research methodology workshops like this in IACON, the MGR Medical University, the Ramaya Institute, CMC Vellore, every institute conducts such methodology workshops every year, but they are thinly attended as we are seeing now. But my request is make use of these opportunities. Second thing, what we usually complain is the poor doctor-patient ratio. So we have less doctors and we have a lot of clinical load to attend to. So we can call it as a problem of plenty, but I can say it is a blessing in disguise for us. We should make use of the numbers to have more research and more publications. So my professor used to tell this example very commonly. So when will Sachin Tendulkar be very happy? When he has to toil throughout the whole day and get 100 runs, or when he goes out for a duck and goes back to the pavilion even within 5 minutes. So even though he will be relaxing, but he may not be happy. So scoring 100 runs is more tiring and painful, but making use of the hard work and getting more publication is what will make us a champion. Another thing we have, the problem is we don't have properly maintained databases. So documentation is the key to successful research. So as I said in the morning, so have a documentation of all the patients you see and operate. It's like a diary of events to look back. Anytime if you want to pull up data and try want to study something, you have the numbers, then definitely you have a good publication. So English language is commonly told as a barrier, and studies have shown that English proficiency was strongly associated with publication output in many high-ranked medical journals. So we don't have a proper solution. We should learn it. And we can get professional help, because a lot of journals offer professional language help for nominal fee if they find that our research work has important implications. So another thing is the publish or perish. The recent Medical Council of India has advised that publication is essential for promotion in academic institutions. So definitely the quality of teaching will improve when our teachers are involved in research. But there are some negative pitfall also, like the time spent on research might take us away from teaching our clinical duties, especially in understaffing specialty departments. And with less resources and training and research, and the quality of research can also be poor. And this may also lead to other problems like ghost authorship, plagiarism. As we see, compared to the earlier 1970s and 80s, where the number of publications was less, number of misconducts and fraud was also less. And later years, the number of publications has also rose along with the misconducts. And also, we need efforts at basic level, like we need a restructuring of the orthopedic research curriculum. And we need to train and increase the next generation of orthopedician, investigators and basic scientists who are keen on doing research. And then we need to have proper infrastructure support. Presently, we have only 1.2% of our GDP spent in research work, which is abysmally low than compared to developed nations. And our past president of IOED, Professor Anil Jain, has put the attitude for research and passion for learning can increase the potential and utility of orthopedic surgeons multifold. So it is more of an attitude and a passion to do research. Especially it is more important in Indian scenario because we have huge patient load and we have human resources to do a lot of this work. And our problems are unique compared to Western countries. And there's still a lot of many hazy areas in orthopedics, spine, etc., where there is lack of evidence, where we can easily pull a lot of research work. So we are different compared to other developed nations, and our diseases are different. The time at which the patients present to us is completely different. So compared to Western population, we should not be listening to the Western literature. With this amount of patient load, we should be providing the guidelines to them. So be the change that you want to see in the world. That's what Mahatma Gandhi told. I hope at least we should be able to do it in the coming years. Thank you.
Thank you, Rishi. We have one more talk by Ashok, and then we'll wind up the program. And he's going to talk on evidence-based medicine. Is it something new?
So the last talk today. So let me ask you, how many of you think that EBM is something new? Can we have raise of hands? How many of you think EBM is new? It's not a catch question. Come on, say yes or say no. How many of you say yes? Nobody? So everybody is the no category. Ah, there is no maybe. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is we are all prejudiced. So we have a lot of influences in our lives. A lot of information or data that we have prejudice us towards seeing what actually is. So the talk is about whether EBM is suffering from the same disease or we are not able to see it or perceive it as it is. Evidence-based medicine, 1990. That is where it originated. Gordon Guyatt in 1990 coined the term accidentally in application on some internal medicine residency program. So it was an accidental discovery. But then, before 1990, were we practicing non-evidence-based medicine? We were always practicing evidence-based medicine. If you look at history, there were case studies where careful men noted what are generally answered better and then began same for their patients. So that's what the doctor's profession is, and has been always. The observational studies has been always there. We carefully observe, clearly recorded description and deductive reasoning. This has served us well till 1900 years. So what happened suddenly? This approach cannot establish causality. So we had issue of whether there is a causal relationship between the disease and the organism or whatever incidence is. The confounding variables affected our decisions and there was huge variability. Most of the doctors were working in isolation. So there were a lot of personal biases. And this is a special case where we try to fit in the explanation according to our perception or our prejudice. So that was the main thing that was against what was being followed for 1900. So there was a need to address this issue. But was EBM the first attempt? No. This was started in 1830 by this French gentleman. And then he introduced the numerical theory and clinical epidemiology. Biostatistics came in. The randomization procedure was first done by Fisher in 1920. And successful trial was conducted in 1931. Bradford Hill is the father of RCT, who has conducted so many of them. And of course, Cochrane. These were established branches before EBM came into play. So these were already established. And the concept of bias was clearly there. All the methodology, the randomized trial, non-randomized trial, cohort, all were established. So what did EBM add? So what did EBM add to all of these? These were already existing. So what was new then? It added a framework and rules to utilize evidence in a systematic manner. That is what it added. So what's new? Sorry, the definition. Conscientious use of current best evidence from healthcare research in making healthcare decisions. The hierarchy was proposed, the evidence cycle of ask, acquire, appraise, and apply, and act was proposed. It was declared as a paradigm shift. And there was huge propaganda. This was happening in early 1990s. There were a lot of positive as well as negative propaganda. So a lot of people were considering this as the best discovery of medicine in the last century, while others were criticizing it completely. Let's see some of the criticism that were put forth. EBM is an epidemiological tool. So we can study an entire population, but individual patients is unreliable. People are not statistical programs that will behave identically. We are complex individuals and behave differently. The current model says that it will combine clinical circumstances, patient preferences with research evidence and clinical expertise. But it doesn't give any framework to how to marry all these three together. There is, even today, there is no framework of how to bring together patient preferences. For example, how can EBM add the patient dislikes Elizaro ring to a blinded, double-blinded, randomized design? It cannot. And then the problem of statistics. Lies, damn lies, and statistics. So it can be used both ways. I spoke earlier on good use of it, but data can be used in any ways. For example, this is the white swan problem, a common perception. So in early days, in the Western world, most of the swans were white. So people consider that swans are always white. Then suddenly down in Australia, they found a white swan. Now what to do? So should the proposition that all swans are white be rejected? And would this black swan be given a place in the reality? That is what is p-value. So what p-value says is less than 0.05 means if there are less than 5 black swans, you can consider that all swans are white. Will you consider that in real world? It's not possible. So true, false, and then there is statistics. And of course, there is fragility of p-value. So population 200, p-value less than 0.05 for a difference of 10. I increase the population, decrease the difference, and p-value is still less than 0.05. The large sample, I'm increasing the sample size, and you see for the difference, the p-value is still significant. Decreasing difference and increasing population. Large sample, small effects become relevant. Sufficiently large sample, you can prove anything to be statistically significant. There's a flaw of large multi-center studies. That's called the fragility of p-value. Again, same thing, population 200, p-value is not significant. So they'll tell you it's underpowered. What do? Increase the sample, 400, p-value becomes significant. 800, p-value becomes significant for a lesser value. So the same thing, you adjust the samples, you adjust the difference, and you get p-value significant. This has been happening very commonly with a lot of publications that have been rated high-level evidence-based publications. Sufficiently large sample can show even small difference as statistically significant. And that's what all about sample size calculation. You can, before the study, manipulate a sample size so that at the end of the study, you get p-value significant. So that's always possible. These are, mind you, criticism of EBM. EBM is unsure. It denotes best evidence as hierarchy, meta-analysis, grades. Hierarchy is the rock on which EBM is built. And since its inception, there are more than 20 revisions of this hierarchy. And the current version there is no consensus which one is the current one. Grading is completely detached from scientific logic. It's based only on the statistics, and the variations of grades are very, very anomalous. There is no field of inquiry other than clinical medicine that tries to grade itself. I mean, no other field of science will try to grade itself except clinical medicines and EBM. EBM proves that it itself is unsound. The fundamental assumption of EBM is that physicians who practice EBM will provide superior care, isn't it? But there is no RCT to say that. 25 years now, and they have not conducted a single study to say that their assumption is true. Again, article can be pre-graded. They'll tell you this is level one, RCT. So you're going to judge the book, but just by the cover of it. You're not going to go into detail and read whether it is really RCT level one or so. And then there are conflicting RCTs. I mean, there are RCTs all over the place that will give you conflicting results, completely opposite to that what one study says something, other says there is no difference, there is negative impact, things like that. And then if RCT is level one, how many RCTs do we need to answer one question? And then how many meta-analysis of RCT and meta-meta-analysis of systematic review? I mean, it just goes on and on, doesn't stop anywhere. And then harmful EBM. For example, this study of BMP, which was graded as very good and grade one study, based on which this got FDA approval. And after some time, we could see all the complications of BMP in spine. EBM founder says that clinical decisions should be based on empirical evidence and that expert opinion is untrustworthy. You know what this quote is based on? It's based on expert opinion by the EBM. Again, is there a middle ground? RCT versus observational studies. Of course there is. So systematic reviews and meta-analysis of non-randomized study can give you equally good results and good quality of conclusions. So there is this overlapping stage here between RCTs and non-RCTs, where if you conduct your observational studies correctly, you'll get good and valid results. So there is always a tussle between clinicians and EBM even now. This is very similar to what happened in 1930 when microbiology evolved. So a clinician thought that microbiologists will now diagnose and treat every disease. Same is the state today. Clinicians think that EBM will give all guidelines and we have to follow them. That's not the thing. Current state of EBM, government can make policy decisions, drug companies can use it, malpractice attorney of course can use it. Use in consulting room, difficult to assess. Individual patient treatment, it may be informed by the evidence. So informed personal opinion is still the valid thing for individual patient. Again, the model has to be changed a bit. Patient preferences have to be taken into account. Clinical circumstances have to be taken into account. There is a model which is circle of evidence that has been proposed rather than the hierarchy of evidence. I think we are moving towards that, where all evidence is at equal level and there is no hierarchy. Whatever is useful for your patient, you can apply and take it ahead. So the pendulum is shifting. In 70s, it was authority, and 90s came the EBM. And now there is somewhere in middle that we are approaching. So research methods are not mutually exclusive, but they are complementary. Is EVM new? Conceptually, yes, but it's still evolving. There is much time left for it to evolve. For example, here, Plato and Aristotle, Plato is pointing towards theoretical basis of knowledge, while Aristotle is pointing towards practical aspect. So wise clinicians will use both. So we'll use our expertise as well as EBM to make our own decisions. So these are a few articles that are on the present concept. Thank you.